Just recently, you know, the Higher Learning Commission put them on probation status, and they decided to throw a Nuremberg rally to try and, you know, like, gain support. And nobody's like, oh yeah, we're gonna analyze the problem, we're gonna try and fix it, you know. Instead, they just, you know, deny and pretend everything's okay.
Thank you for joining us for another edition of the Watching Atoms podcast. I'm Danny Ladoni. Today we're talking with Drew Lamprecht. He's a former Adams State University student. He wasn't able to finish his degree at Adams State and talks about some of the challenges that he faced while a student at Adams State. He talks in detail about the situation he encountered when he reached out to the president of the university in an effort to better understand why I, Danny Ladoni, was banned from campus, and went on to also discuss a screening he organized of a documentary film that I made and why he decided to host that screening among students at Adams State. He also shares observations about how he felt that academic rigor was not a high priority for the institution, particularly for his peers, and that he questioned whether the value of the degree he was receiving at Adams State was worth the increased tuition he found himself paying semester after semester. All that and more on this edition of the Watching Atoms podcast.
My name is Drew Lamprecht. I am now a former Adams State student. I first attended in 2012. I was accepted as a theater major originally, and then I soon switched to English. I worked for the radio station, KASF, and I left for a little while. I did really poorly my first year. I didn't have the same drive that I did, you know, now. Then I came back, you know, reattended, did really well. And then that's when I, you know, started learning enough about the university and its practices that I wasn't, you know, happy to stay there. So now I left, and I'm currently searching for another school to attend.
So, of course, many students do research projects while at Adams State, but it sounds like you've done something of a research project on Adams State.
Yeah.
Really, what brought about this podcast episode is one day I'm checking my email inbox, and I get a comment for Watching Atoms from you. And, of course, we've known each other for a while. You took a class or two from me. I know that you took my screenwriting class when I taught there, and so I see this comment from you. It had so many things that I think were worth talking about or I wanted to know more about, and then I thought, well, rather than writing him back, if he's around, maybe we could just do a podcast. So I'd like to have you start by reading aloud the comment that you left that day, and we'll kind of go from there.
Okay, perfect, yeah. All right, so this was left on February 19th. I wrote an email to Dr. McClure in the wake of the issuance of the PNG against Danny, and I never received a reply from the eager-to-listen president. I was and still am in support of Danny Ladoni. The president has shown that she would rather let the school get sued than admit she was in the wrong. I left Adams State this semester for multiple reasons, but first and foremost was the administration of ASU. I was close to graduating, but have decided that a different school is right for me, and probably for many other students who attend. A culture of ignorance pervades the detached student body. In one of my 400-level English classes in the fall semester, the class complained that we had to read too much. Clearly, academics are of little priority to many students, and especially to the administration. I liked all my teachers, and I knew many other students as dedicated to learning as I was, but we all felt neglected by the institution of higher education. Adams State University is most certainly broken, and I can only hope that whichever school I end up choosing will accept the majority of my credits.
Yeah, and just to be clear, this was written before the Higher Learning Commission sanctioned Adams State with academic probation.
That's right, yeah, absolutely. And I honestly wasn't that surprised when I found out that they did that. There's a more positive attitude towards athletics than there are academics. And I'm sure that's, you know, not just here, but that happens in a lot of institutions. So I don't want to say it's, you know, solely Adams State, but...
So let's go through this a little bit. There were a few things that kind of jumped out at me, and we'll go from there. I think first and foremost, I can't talk in detail about the lawsuit because it's still ongoing.
Absolutely, yeah.
But what I can say is that you knew me while I was teaching at Adams State. You probably heard something about me being banned from campus. You got probably the same email that all the students did about why I was banned or something like that. And then you and some other students decided to organize a campus screening and Q&A with me for the documentary playing Columbine. Can you talk about why you decided to do that and what that process was like?
first of all, there were a lot of people that didn't really understand the game in the first place. And I had played it before I even came to Adam State. It was something that I, you know, had learned about and tried out. So I played the game. And I definitely think that, you know, a lot of the students and a lot of the faculty didn't understand what its purpose was, its intention was.
So this is the 2005 video game called Super Columbine Massacre RPG. It's a role-playing game where you assume the identities of Eric Harris and Dylan Klebold, the two school shooters from Columbine. And this game, of course, was downloaded widely. It was reviled. It was praised. Of course, I went on with my life after I made it. I taught at Adam State for 4 years. And then the police chief at Adam State, Paul Grahowski, cited the game as the very first item as to why I had to be banned from campus for the safety of all involved. And you knew about the game prior to that, of course. Mm-hmm. And so this was something that you were already familiar with.
Yeah, absolutely. And everyone had already known that you'd made that game. And then now, you know, out of the blue, all of a sudden, it was a reason for you to be banned from campus. And, you know, you were a safety threat. And for some reason, you making this game, you know, 10 years prior, all of a sudden now it means that you're a threat to campus safety. So we decided to show this movie, maybe to help some other people at Adam State understand, you know, why the game was made. You know, maybe even just that violence in video games isn't necessarily a cause of violence in the real world. It was actually pretty easy to get the turnout there. And normally, Adam State students are kind of hard to get up, you know, to make them come out and do things. But we had a really good, really, really decent turnout that day. And I was very impressed with that. And I thought it was very productive. And so we just made a Facebook page and it just kind of spread through word of mouth. We had some flyers that got put up. And I thought a really, you know, informative Q&A after it, you know, despite the technical difficulties.
You know, the student body and others at Adam State kind of did what they thought they could do, which is, you know, voice their concerns and, you know, get together. There was a letter that was circulated and signed by many people. It was going to run in the Valley Courier, but due to some timing issues, people decided they'd rather just have it run at Watching Adams. But it's interesting, just the act of getting people to sign a letter has such political implications. There were many people, as I understand it, who saw this letter. And the article, by the way, is called Adam State Fails to Act in Students' Best Interest. And it basically talked about how if Danny Ladone really was a threat to campus safety, the administration did all the wrong things.
Mm-hmm, right? Absolutely,
They didn't take any of the steps that you would want in terms of actually searching the individual's home, actually interviewing them or evaluating their capacity for violence, and instead you just kind of isolate and humiliate them in, you know, in the hopes that they'll go away. But there's no research that suggests that that's how you would handle, you know, the FBI and Secret Service recommends really the opposite. Like, keep the person engaged, help understand what's going on. Mm-hmm. And Adam State did kind of the opposite, or did the opposite of that. But many people who read that letter said, I'd really like to sign it, but I can't put my name on it. I mean, the whole reason that there's this website that exists, Watching Adams, and all of these things happen with former students and faculty and anonymous comments and unsourced articles is because the culture of fear and retaliation at Adam State is so strong.
Mm-hmm.
I wanted to talk about, irrespective of that, why did you not choose to stay at Adam State? Why? And how much did this issue even influence what sounds like or a lot of other things that are going on?
The reactions of the university, like, okay, so I don't think that you're a threat to campus safety at all.
You're in my house right now, I would imagine.
Exactly. Yeah. Even if there were a threat to campus safety, just banning them and then leaving it at that is not the right course of action, like you said. And it's kind of funny how that ties into the video game itself, because I always thought that it was trying to show, you know, the steps that could have been taken and to try to prevent the tragedy in the first place. There were signs, and these students were, you know, isolated, and nobody was engaging them, and that's why it happened. So first of all, like, they want to protect our safety, but it doesn't seem like they can. So that was reason number one. So reason number two, I guess, would be the campus's their reaction towards anything that's negative on them. It's never responded with, oh, we're going to try and fix the problem or anything. Just recently, you know, the Higher Learning Commission put them on probation status. and they decide to throw a Nuremberg rally to try and, you know, like, gain support. And nobody's like, oh yeah, we're gonna analyze the problem, we're gonna try and fix it, you know. Instead, they just, you know, deny and pretend everything's okay.
So when you say Nuremberg rally, I presume you're referring to the Standing Strong for ASU parade, yeah, that happened just before spring break.
Yeah, absolutely. And that's...
Now, why would you call it a Nuremberg rally?
Well, it seems almost like it's, you know, there was a celebration of Beverlee McClure, and that's what all this was. You know, you celebrate the Nazi party, or you celebrate... I don't want to compare her to Hitler or anything, but it's not like anyone's saying... there's not a... How should I put this? It's not an intellectual engagement. It's more of a propaganda sort of thing. So you use like, oh yeah, let's just blindly support ASU and blindly support all their actions without actually thinking about it, or, you know, anything like that. And a lot of students just kind of followed suit. They didn't want to think for themselves in that situation. So
it does seem curious that when you get placed on academic probation, your response is to throw a parade.
Yeah, exactly. And they could have had many other responses besides that. You know, they could have been like, well, we disagree with this, but this is what we've done to, you know, improve our standing with the Higher Learning Commission. You know, you don't just say, oh yeah, okay, instead we're just gonna be positive about this.
I imagine if an individual student was caught cheating on a test or didn't cite their sources in a paper or something like this, and the teacher said, okay, you've committed plagiarism, or I caught you cheating on a test, we're going to place you on academic probation, and your response was, how dare you? Everyone is cheating on the same test. You're just singling me out as some kind of a political statement. Yeah, I'm going to call you out for trying to make me the whipping boy of the class, and yeah, now I'm going to throw a parade around campus to show how everyone supports me, because it's not my fault that I cheated on a test.
Yeah, exactly. And so that's the reason number two, I didn't like the administration's response to any of those things.
So just to be clear, last semester you wrote an email to Dr. McClure in response to the email that she sent to the campus-wide to all students. Mm. First of all, even for a moment, when you read the police chief's words, or when you read Dr. McClure's email, did you pause and think, maybe Danny did do something terrible?
Oh, absolutely, yeah. I mean, and it has that tone. Yeah. It's like, oh, there's something really terrible that we know and you don't, you know? So you have to believe us, and that's, you know, this is why we're doing this, and you just have to accept our word because we're trying to protect you. And that's when you have to start to get, you know, a little skeptical when someone's telling you, like, we're just trying to protect your safety, and that's why we can't tell you what's going on. And, or, you know, we have all this secret information that you don't know, and that's why we're doing this. Most of the time, there is no secret information. Like you said, it's a culture of fear. They're instilling fear into people in order to isolate someone who has fallen out of favor with the party.
So you never got a response to your email to Dr. McClure?
No, I emailed her that very same day. They sent out an email, again, just reaffirming the exact same position that they've had the entire time. And basically, I laid down all of my concerns with the situation and concerns that I had with the school itself as far as retention rates and things like that. And she always said that she was, you know, open, and she wanted to, you know, get students' opinions on things. I never received a response. Later, she did claim that she had read my email and that she thought she had gotten back to me, and it, you know, slipped her mind or whatever. But even when confronted with information that may contradict what she's saying, her only response has ever been, you know, you've been misinformed. That's not what happened. This happened. It's just, no, you're wrong. You don't know what you're talking about. I do. Just listen to me. It's an infantilization of the student body.
So you weren't really being treated like an adult in that capacity?
Yeah, exactly. Everyone who attends Adams State is, you know, a young adult, 18 and up. I mean, I'm sure there's some 17-year-olds that attend, but
Some concurrent students, but I think for most legal purposes, enrollment at the age of 18 is a prerequisite for everything from students having their grades being confidential from their parents. That's kind of an issue that just the general environment of a campus, including the way that faculty conduct themselves. When I build a syllabus for a class, I'm working off the assumption that I can show R-rated movie clips because everyone's an adult.
Yeah. And I think that they should be addressed as such. You know, you can't just say, like, we're just trying to protect you, you know. You can't just stand in as a surrogate parent if you're administration. Even the teachers, you know, they don't act like that when you're in class. They say, you know, we're not here to babysit you. We're here to teach you. We're not here to, you know, hold your hand through this entire process. If you want to learn, you have to learn yourself. But the administration, for whatever reason, feels differently.
So you're saying the faculty at Adams State generally do treat students as adult learners.
Mm-hmm, exactly, yeah. And I've never had a problem with the faculty. I even said that in the email. Every teacher that I've had at Adams State, I've always had a really positive experience with. It's just, you know, the administration, for whatever reason, seems to not be, you know, serving its role. And actually, when I first discovered this case, or I read into it more, I was reading on the Foundation for Individual Rights in Education. I was reading about the Yale incident with an email that went out. And it was the same situation there. A teacher basically said, you know, I don't think you need to be babying these kids. I think they're adults. If for whatever reason they do something inappropriate, they have their own repercussions for that.
This is the email that went out about offensive Halloween costumes.
Exactly, yeah.
And this culminated in this YouTube confrontation that everyone has seen where a student says, you know, this is not about creating an intellectual space. This is about creating a home. Mm-hmm. It's about creating a safe space for us.
Yeah.
And it was whatever you think of the words, the way it was delivered was pretty confrontational. And
exactly.
It brought out this whole question of, is this a home? Is this a learning institution? Can adults handle offensive Halloween costumes?
Yeah, and that's what seems to be the trend. The administrations in higher learning institutions seem to be getting bigger and bigger and seem to be getting, you know, less open academically. They feel like they have to babysit these kids. And what's interesting about that case too is that these kids who felt like they were victims started behaving like a bully because of that.
You know, I was talking with a friend yesterday about the case in Missouri with the students who were having a demonstration, and there's actually a faculty member who is among them, and there's a member of the student press with a camera trying to cover a protest. And you'd think, all right, so the purpose of a protest is to get attention, is to have the media there. They're part of the proposition of having a demonstration. And yet this professor was like, you know, get out of here. We're creating a safe space and you're violating that. I need some muscle over here to kind of push the student out. And it became a huge ordeal. And it just really inverted the whole idea of like, well, what is free speech and who gets the opportunity to be heard, and who are the adults that were trying to protect their individual rights here?
Yeah, exactly. And that's kind of a trend that I've started to see. There's this ultra-progressive ideology that starts to, you know, it may be well-intentioned, but it starts to kind of start working in the opposite direction. You know, instead of you feeling victimized for whatever reason, you start to victimize other just because of that fact.
The term I've heard applied for this is the regressive left.
Regressive left.
Instead of the progressive left, if the left ends up undermining its own values of free speech and individual liberty, etc., it erodes the very values that it's trying to protect. And we've seen that many places. So let me go on to the second paragraph you wrote, because there you talk more about your individual experiences, feeling like you were in a 400 level, probably like senior level English class, and some of your colleagues or your peers were complaining about having too much reading.
Yeah.
And that, wouldn't you like less reading in a class? Why not?
Well, sure. Yeah, but I mean, I'm paying, you know, $300 some per credit hour, and I want to take away as much as I possibly can from this class. It's, first of all, you need to, you know, match the expectations. Sure, if it's, you know, English 210, which is Intro to Literature, and you say, oh, we're reading too much, for people that may not necessarily be English majors or don't need it for the major, it's just a general education requirement. Sure, then by all means, reduce the amount of reading if that's something that they can't keep up with. But by now, in a 400 level class, you know, everyone's upper level, they, you know, should be able to handle the course load at that point. You should be able to balance, you know, your work and life together, your recreation time, your homework. And honestly, it's they weren't asking us to do, you know, 100 math problems over and over and over again. It's reading. It's easy. It's probably, you know, the most basic stuff. And it was just to be able to have a productive discussion with your classmates that same same day. So if I had done the reading and nobody else did, you know, I'm not going to be able to discuss this piece of literature that we're supposed to be reading.
You know, one of the things I talked about with the Colorado AAUP co-president, Jonathan Reese, was that some of the value of college and academic freedom isn't just from your professors, but it's also from your peers. It's also from the other students that you interact with and how they help you engage with the material and give you other perspectives. So in that sense, did you feel like you looked around the room at some of your peers and thought, I don't know if I really fit in here. I don't know if they share the same goals or priorities or commitment to, you know, my academic success as I do.
All the time. You know, I plan on going to grad school at some point, you know. You know, I keep on having, you know, a few setbacks and everything, but I plan on continuing my education. And I do strive for, you know, the highest grade I can possibly get. And it seems in a lot of classes that I have, there's just students that they're just trying to get by. They just want to make it out. And it's a little difficult as a student with your fellow classmates if they don't have the same dedication to learning that you do. And I'm not saying all the students are like that way. A lot of students do have the same, you know, aspirations and dedication to learning. But, you know, again, there's a lot that don't. And it seems to me that at Adams State, there's more. I've been to other schools, you know, community college, and even there, students were more dedicated to trying in the class than just trying to be like, oh yeah, just trying to coast through and get it over with. It's like they think that once they get this magical bachelor's degree, they're set. You know, you don't have to work towards it. You get your degree and then you get a great job and then that's it, you know? I don't think they understand that the harder you work, the further you'll go.
One observation I would share, and certainly we're talking in general terms about many students who have different experiences, but my thought would be, in my time at teaching at Adams State, just conversing with students about their schedules and about what's going on in their life, it became so clear to me that they were being pushed to take 15 credit hours so they could graduate in 4 years. But in order to pay for that, many of them also had, you know, jobs on evenings, on weekends. Student athletes, of course, I mean, talking about the day in the life of a student athlete, getting up at 5:30 in the morning so they can go to practice or they can work out before they go to class, and then they have practice and then they have tutoring for their classes, and it's a lot of strain. And so I can imagine if you're in a class, you're working a job, you might even have a family at home. I mean, a lot of Adams State students are either providing for their family or they're helping taking care of kids or an elderly relative or someone else. It's a really substantial workload. I hate to say it, but in part it comes down to how much students are now expected to pay for their own education. And so either they go into debt, and do lots of extra work study or work on the side, or, you know, it's a blessing if all you had to do was focus on the classes you're taking and that you didn't have, you know, an athletic scholarship to maintain and evening or weekend job as well.
Absolutely, yeah, and especially student athletes. That's a really heavy course load. And then, you know, you're always out on the road and you're missing classes, and that can always be, you know, detrimental to your learning.
But and if you're in football, you might be sustaining head injuries. So the very things you're learning in the morning, you're forgetting in the afternoon.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, what's the chronic microencephalopathy? But yeah, so there is a really heavy course load. But again, the focus of all of that was the education.
That's difficult why you're at school, right?
Exactly. Yeah. And that's why, you know, you're an athlete, you know, of course you enjoy the sports. But yeah, you may have a scholarship, so you need to keep up, you know, your schedule with both of those. And you may be working a part-time job for, you know, just spending cash or living cash or to pay for your tuition as well.
And it's not that likely that most Adams State students will go on to play for the NBA or the NFL.
Yeah. I mean, of course, there's always the chance that they can. It's a little sad that, you know, you do have to work that much, even just to go to a school like Adams State. Because, like I said, I brought some facts and figures here about tuition rates, especially around the state. Adams State currently is at $302 per credit hour.
The average class is 3 credit hours, so you're looking at about $900 a class.
Exactly.
And there are about 120 credits on a degree plan.
Yeah.
So at that rate, you're looking at $36,000.
Yeah, exactly. And a school of a similar size, CSU Pueblo, they're at $303 per credit hour. The median starting income for a bachelor's graduate from both of these schools. ASU, you're looking at $32,000 per year. That's the median income. You know, it could be a little more or a little less.
And CSU, in the Valley, it could be less. In Denver, it could be more.
Exactly, yeah. And CSU Pueblo's at $37,000. And these are you're paying for the same price of these schools. You've got $302 versus $303 per credit hour.
But where are you getting some of your data from?
This is from collegemeasures.org. And then the tuition rates are from the respective university websites themselves.
So you're looking at, when I go to a school and I'm paying this amount to get my degree, what in terms of the value of that degree will I see as a result of what I've spent on college?
Exactly, yeah. And I think, I mean, like I said, you know, it's not just, you don't just get a bachelor's degree and then you're set for life. Every university obviously has different contacts, and every university is in different locations. It comes down to the fact that you could be paying almost the exact same amount and on average could be earning $5,000 more per year, which is pretty substantial if you think about it. That's a lot more to be earning for a dollar more per credit hour.
Mm-hmm. So these are some of the reasons why you decided you didn't want to stay at Adams State and you're hoping that your credits transfer?
Absolutely, yeah. And this is, you know, reason three. It wasn't as high of a priority on my list because obviously, you know, there's always exceptions. It just, like I said, it depends on how hardworking you are and how dedicated you are to, you know, finding the career in your field and finding a job that's high enough paying and something that, you know, suits you well.
What are some of your career interests, and how has that changed since you arrived at Adams?
I came to Adams State because my entire plan that I had from when I graduated high school got completely upturned. I graduated, I went to film school, which was what I wanted to do. And then my apartment had this fire and I got kicked out. I had to move back home away from the school. I lived in Colorado Springs, the school was in Denver. And then one of my friends came to Adams State and I was like, yeah, sure, that sounds good, without doing a whole lot of research. And again, this is probably why I didn't do too well my first year. I didn't really have a goal in mind or a direction that I was trying to go to. And then I started thinking about, you know, graduate school. I was just working a job after I left Adams State, the first year that is. I was just working, you know, a minimum wage job in Colorado Springs. And I was like, you know, where am I going to go with this? I can't go anywhere further from here. So I decided to come back. And I was planning on going to law school, which is why all of this stuff is of particular interest to me. Again, that's another reason why I'm starting to get worried about Adams State. You know, maybe some law schools will see, you know, oh, this is a degree from Adams State. You know, what kind of education did this guy have? You know, no matter how high my LSAT scores were. Now, you know, I still plan on doing that.
So just to clarify, in addition to some of the return on investment figures you cited earlier, you also just described kind of a reputational issue that, to some degree, when you get your diploma, who it's from matters, like the difference between Adams State and Harvard, right?
Absolutely.
Different institutions. And so you feel like the reputation that Adams State has as a result of some of the things we've talked about is devaluing what ostensibly your degree would be worth.
Absolutely, yeah. I mean, when you're going to law school and, you know, I'm really interested in constitutional law. And if you want to become a constitutional lawyer and you see this school that one of the prospective students went to is being sued by the ACLU, you know, how great can this student be? And I'm not necessarily saying that, you know, the education is worth less. You know, they say that a lot, you know, it doesn't matter what school you go to, the education's the same, you know, but the name does. Like you said, you know, you go to Harvard and they have, you know, a huge network of alumni that can get you into different jobs and everything. The fact of it comes down to when a school starts violating rights and starts behaving the way it is, it seems like, you know, maybe a more serious school will start to look down on that. I mean, even the AAUP denounced Beverlee McClure's actions as far as the persona non grata policy goes.
And certainly the issue of the Higher Learning Commission sanctioning Adams State, the Chronicle for Higher Education now writing several times about these issues with extended studies and problems with verifying test results, as well as questioning the academic rigor, both in the content of the courses and also in the number of students that are in some of these online sections. If you read the report, it was like 450 to 600 students in individual sections of these online classes, and some of them being taught by professors who are already teaching a full-time load on campus, and many students probably liking the fact that they didn't have to go to class as much. And so everyone was kind of cutting those corners, and they finally got caught.
Yeah, and that's exactly what I said earlier, you know, maybe these students don't have this, you know, dedication to getting their money's worth. You're paying a lot of money to invest in your own future. A lot of students may have liked having this class shorter, but it comes down to you not getting the education you're trying to pay for and the future that you're trying to invest in.
I always had students who were eager if I could end class early, and having been a student myself, which every professor has, we can certainly relate to that.
Of course.
But yeah, at the same time, I remember when I was at Emerson for undergrad, I did a kind of cost analysis, and I realized each class that I attended that day was worth about $55.
Wow.
And so any day that I thought about sleeping in, I thought, is it worth paying $55 to sleep through class today? Probably not.
Yeah. And that's a good idea to have. You know, you think about, you know, how much you're paying, and then yeah, it's a really good motivator to get to class if you think about that.
So let me ask, Adams State this fall is rolling out a guaranteed tuition program such that if you enroll at Adams State, they will lock your tuition at a set rate of increase of 2.5% for each year thereafter. And it has some merits in the idea that students can better plan for their total financial need to go to college. But Adams State is hoping that this will be a way to attract and retain students. Why has it not been sufficiently persuasive to keep you coming back?
To me, at first, it seemed like the only reason they were doing this is because they want to keep on increasing tuition, and they don't want to upset current students that, you know, may have been paying a certain amount. I can't remember how much I paid my first year here, but it was a lot less than I had paid these past couple semesters that I attended.
Do you know Richard Flem?
I do, yeah.
So I interviewed him for the podcast series, and he said it was kind of bewildering how every semester, every year, he would see his tuition go up. And yet when he went for basic services, like getting a math tutor so that he could take the GRE, they said, well, you're not in a current math class. We can't give you a math tutor. He's like, what are you talking about? I'm paying full tuition. It goes up every year. And what am I getting for what I'm paying for?
Yeah, and that's a good question, too. Where's all that money going? If they're not making it available to the students who are paying that increase, who's getting that money? My thought is, you know, immediately turns to administration. The administration swells, and these people, you know, get raises and everything. And then while you, the student, the burden falls on you, and you're not really getting a return on that tuition increase.
We did identify about 24 administrative positions, according to their salary data, that are making above 100% of what their peers make at other institutions, even while most faculty and staff make 70 to 75% of what their peers make at other institutions. And frankly, until Watching Adams published this, most people did not know how disparate those pay scales were. One of the issues with a variety of states in the country, certainly Colorado, is that the amount of tuition burden has shifted onto students and away from the taxpayers of the state, in Colorado specifically because of something called TABOR, which caps the amount that institutions can allocate funding for education, K-12 and higher ed. So even if Colorado gets a windfall of tax revenue from the number of people that are now moving to the state, could be for Amendment 64, could be for other reasons, that we don't see those dollars going to education. And in fact, Colorado is one of 11 states in the U.S. That spend more money on its prison system than on higher education.
Yeah, and that's not a figure that surprises me either. And that's really unfortunate that happens. You know, I'm a fan of, you know, higher education, and I think education's important, but I guess there's more money in prison, you know?
So if you could do it all over again, what would you do differently?
Probably would have thought a lot more about, you know, the school that I was choosing. And one of the attractive things about Adams State back in 2012 when I first went was that it was so affordable, and that they did have, you know, really great academics. And I didn't know too much about the school at the time. Yeah, that's all, you know, just plan things out a little bit better than I already had. I don't think it's too late, but, you know, I learned later than I should have how all this stuff affects me as a student. And I think a lot of students should think about things like that.
Because every student who enrolls at Adams State takes on debt, takes classes, and doesn't graduate is really a black mark on the institution, which is why it has something like a 21% four-year graduation rate. That's only one in five students that start at Adams State their freshman year will graduate 4 years later.
And that's a really low statistic.
The average nationally is about 50%.
Yeah.
Which is still a lot lower than you'd hope. But
exactly, yeah.
One thing that Richard said, maybe you could echo this or maybe you feel differently. He was struggling with the fact that as a black non-athlete, many people assumed he was there to play a sport, right? Because if you're a black student at Adams State, everyone's like, oh, what sport do you play? But he said, well, no, I'm here for an English degree. I'm interested in creative writing. And so he was smart, very gifted student, getting very good grades. And he's like, okay, so I'm getting really good grades. What academic scholarships are available for me? And he's like, oh, there aren't any.
Yeah, and that was the next point I was going to bring up. Yeah, the scholarship situation. You can be a phenomenal student at Adams State, and there's very, very little money in it for you, unless you graduated high school with honors and everything, and you get a full ride academic scholarship when you first enter. Every student's different. Every situation's different. You know, me, I bloomed a little bit later. I didn't start getting good grades until I came back, and even there, there's no scholarships in that. It's like almost like they don't want you. They want you to not come to the school. So yeah, I definitely agree with that. I would like to see more money as far as scholarships goes for students that are doing really well, because that might help keep those good students, the ones that are graduating right now, and it may help students that probably would leave stay. So students that are doing well, but maybe don't like the school, or maybe it's just getting too expensive for them, and they're not seeing the benefit in going there.
So maybe instead of guaranteed tuition increases, they could have guaranteed academic scholarships for students who qualify. Or
exactly.
Like
yeah.
So if you were president for a day, or say for a year or something like that, you've had some choice words for how the administration has handled my situation and then some other broader problems. What would you do differently?
You could implement, openness. That would be a great, starting point.
Openness.
Openness.
A transparent and open administration.
Exactly. Yeah. Kind of like, the Soviet Union, glasnost and perestroika, that's what you should first do to implement changes. Make sure that the students know exactly what they're getting, and be upfront with what the administration is doing in order to protect you, in order to protect the campus.
Do you think that part of the issue, since you talked about your peers who were reticent to have more reading assignments in 400-level classes, do you think part of it is the kind of students Adams State attracts? Perhaps students who may not even really be ready for college yet, or may not have a clear directive about what they want to do in college, and so they sort of flounder and essentially bring down the overall graduation rates because they're bringing in students who really have no business being in college yet?
Yeah, that has definitely been a thought that has occurred to me. I've always thought a lot of the people I knew my freshman year, none of them are here anymore, and they were all very similar to me in that way. They never went to class. They never, did their assignments. They never studied. And I think, yeah, definitely, they weren't prepared. They were not ready for college. They weren't really, they didn't really know what they wanted to do. They didn't really know why they were in college in the first place, or why they even needed to go to college in the first place. And that was certally me. I didn't know what I was supposed to be doing, or why I was even here in the first place. And
I know that some people thought, okay, great, Adams State College is becoming Adams State University, so does that mean that we have more course waivers so that we can conduct research? No. Does that mean that we have more resources to be able to organize academic programs, go to conferences, bring students? No. So what does it mean? It's mostly a marketing tool.
Exactly. Yeah, it sounds better. It sounds like you're getting a better education if you go to a university as opposed to a college. And, again, like that campus culture too, students get here and maybe it's not what they expected. It's not, they expect to go to university and meet all kinds of new people and, be involved in all kinds of clubs. And
be able to get a math tutor.
Exactly. That too. Yeah. And then you get here and you're like, wow, what is this even? I get to go to class and nobody's ever around. You'll walk around campus, maybe just try and start a friendly conversation with someone and it's dead. There's nobody around,
But you're ultimately working toward a four-year degree, and you'd also like to go to grad school at some point.
Exactly, yep.
Mm-hmm. Thank you for your time today.
Absolutely, yeah.